Well, good morning, Harvest. Good to see you this morning. I am very excited to be sharing God's word with you this morning. I'm very excited about what the Lord is doing in our church. But I realize that not everyone is there when they come to church. Many of us are in the midst of some serious and fierce trials. And today, in our passage in Mark 6, we're going to see that our disciples are fighting against the winds and the waves of a fierce storm. And today's message is for those of you that have the wind against you. It's wailing and it's howling. At every turn, it seems to be getting more hopeless. With every effort that you make, it seems to be more futile. And so this message is for you today. But some of us are here today and the wind's at our back. And things are smooth sailing. And it's a great time to give praise to God. And you should praise God. But know, in this life, the wind will change. So this message actually is for everyone. I'm a father of five. I love being a father, and I remember back to the days when my kids were young. We had five under 10, and you can imagine what it's like. Some of us know what it's like with a lot of kids, and it's super fun to be dad to young kids. We're going to see today that Jesus walks on water, but when your kids are young, they think that dad walks on water sometimes. That's funny. When they get a little older, they just think dad's all wet, but I remember, and many of you parents know this, when there is a loud storm in the middle of the night, where do the kids come? The kids come into dad and mom's room. They come running in because they're afraid. I loved those days. Brian used to come running in, that little guy over there. We used to say, when the kids would come in at night and it was really, really loud thunder, we'd say that Jesus and the angels were bowling, I tell them. But why did they come? I didn't even need to say anything. They just wanted to get into the presence of their dad and their mom. And I couldn't stop the storm. But there is someone who created the storm. There is someone who can stop the storm, and there is someone who can protect you in the storm, and there is someone that actually walks on water. And we need to get to his presence in the middle of the storm. And when I say his, who do I mean? Say his name. Say it a little louder.
Jesus.
We need to get to Jesus in the midst of our storm. Jesus. Just Jesus. Just Jesus is the name of our sermon series and Mark, and it's been a great journey. And today the title of our message in Mark chapter 6 is, It Is I, Power in His Presence. So you can grab your Bibles and turn to Mark 6. We're going to be in verses 45 through 56, and as you do that, I just want to pray. Oh, Father, we thank you for the one we just sang about, your son, Jesus. And we also, God, at this time ask for the third person of the Trinity to come now. We invite you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, preach. Holy Spirit, minister to every heart. Holy Spirit, convict. Holy Spirit, encourage. Oh, God, come by your Holy Spirit now and move among us. God, move in my words. Would my words not be of plausible words of wisdom, but a demonstration of spirit and of power? Your spirit move. God, I can say anything up here, but your spirit can take it and move in the hearts of the people that they might see you and move towards you and increasingly greater devotion and love, and we pray for that. God, we're going to talk about a lot of things from your word. But God, this might be the most important part of the sermon, just to call out to you in prayer. So come now as we open up your word together. We invite you here in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, hopefully you got your Bibles open. It's going to be fun together this morning. It's a great passage of Scripture. Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 45, the first word says immediately. And so this begs to help us look back to what it's immediately after. And if you were with us last week, Dave Stone talked about, Pastor Stone, we had the story of the loaves and the fishes. And at the end of that story, Jesus asked the disciples to gather all up what is left, and they gather 12 baskets full of the leftovers. God just provides an abundance, doesn't he? So cool. There were 12 baskets left over. And then we come to verse 45. He says, immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side to Bethsaida while he dismissed the crowd. So it starts immediately. He made the disciples get into the boat. Actually, when you study this, when he makes them, this is an emphatic, this is an urgent command from Jesus. So he's kind of like, you guys got to get in the boat and get in the boat now. And I'm kind of imagining what would have been going through the disciples' minds. They just witnessed this amazing miracle. It says in John's gospel, it was so amazing that the people wanted to make Jesus king right there because it was such an amazing miracle. And the disciples are told right after the miracle to get into the boat. I'm guessing the disciples would not have chosen that. What would you want to do after you witnessed a great miracle by Jesus like that? What would you want to do? I'd want to praise Jesus. I'd want to talk to him about it. I'd want to get some insight on how it happened. Why did you do it? How does this happen? Let's process this together, Jesus. Let's process this. Let's talk about it. Help us understand what just happened. But no, Jesus says, get in the boat and go to the other side, and I'll meet you there. The disciples want a conversation debrief, which is totally understandable, but Jesus is going to give them a demonstration debrief. And it's coming. And it's coming. Jesus doesn't always give us what we want, but he always gives us what we need. He has a plan, and he's completely in control, and that's the first point of our message today. It is I am sovereign over your storm. Jesus knows exactly what's going on. He has a plan. He's in control. He is sovereign over your storm. Look what happens next. He dismisses the crowd, verse 46. After he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. I love this. Jesus gets alone with the Father. It's one of my favorite attributes of Jesus is his prayerful nature. He's always prioritizing prayer with the Father. And how much more do I need to prioritize being the sinful man that I am and the mess that I am? How much more do I need to prioritize my personal time with Jesus if the second person of the Trinity did it? He's always prioritizing time with the Father, and he gets away and he gets alone. He goes up onto the mountain. You can see it there. He went up on the mountain to pray. He was such a great example of fervent prayer that in Luke 11, you guys know this, what Jesus, those disciples asked Jesus to teach them to pray. That's the only thing in the scriptures we see where they actually ask him to teach them something specific. They had seen Jesus' life and were so desirous of how Jesus prayed that they asked him to teach them. Prayer. Prayer. It's a pillar of our church, believing firmly in the power of prayer. And I love this quote by Oswald Chambers. And Jesus practiced this. Here it is. Prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. You can see I was applying that even today when we were getting ready for the sermon. When I was praying, I'm like, this is it, God. As we're praying, I'm going to give a sermon, but God, it's our calling out to you. It's your spirit that's got to move. It doesn't matter what I say. And Jesus understood that. He was committed to prayer. What a great example to us. Love that. Verse 47. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. So a little bit about the Sea of Galilee. Here's a picture of the Sea of Galilee. All right, the Sea of Galilee is 13 miles long by 8 miles wide. You can kind of see, you can see the other side. It actually goes a little more farther to the left, and the longest part's actually to the left. We're looking actually kind of the direction where the fishes and loaves would be, kind of down there, right straight down, and then Bethsaida would be off to the right, so kind of like straight across, okay? So the Sea of Galilee, it's beautiful. I was there, 2 years ago, November already now? Chris, was it 2 years ago? 2 years ago. It's beautiful, but it's not super big, but it's super prone to quick, violent, big storms. I don't quite understand the geographical reason for it, but it's known for that even to this day. Many wrecks still happen at the Sea of Galilee, all right? So this is not a big surprise. I'm sure the fishermen, the four guys, might have even sensed it when they got in the boat. They have a lot of skill. They probably could have sensed that maybe a storm was coming. That's just a little bit about the Sea of Galilee. They're about ready to get into one of them. And so they set off, and Jesus is watching. He's on the shore alone, on the mountain, and they make way. And they head out, and the wind pushes it out and pushes the boat out into the middle of the sea. In Matthew's version of this gospel, it says the waves were beating against the boat. They're making headway painfully. Think about it. These are guys, there's four of them that are professional fishermen, plus the other eight, and they're out in the middle, and the winds and the waves are crashing up against them, and they are painfully making way. A lot of pain and no gain. The waves are beating against the boat. The boat is rocking. The baskets of bread, I'm sure, have toppled over, and now there's bread that's floating along, the little bit of water that might be in the bottom of the boat. The baskets are toppling over. Maybe Philip grabbed a basket and started to use the basket to maybe bail some water out. But they're fighting. They're painfully fighting to make headway. Everyone can handle a bad wave or two. But when the waves keep coming and coming and coming, and the effort that you're giving is actually you're going backwards. You ever felt like that? Felt like that in your life when you're facing a situation, whether it's at work or maybe in a relationship or in your finances or in your health? You're doing everything you can, but it's all futile. You're going nowhere. 2019 was kind of like that for me. The whirlwind of change and trial into the life of Greg Bradshaw, into the life of Harvest Bible Chapel. There were days, I see Rick Cordy here. Hi, Rick. Rick did such a great job. God raised up Rick at the right time to help us and kind of right the ship. But the winds and the waves were against us. Eddie's here, Todd's here, part of the leadership team. We would come into work some days, brothers and sisters, and we would be like, what the heck is happening, God? We're working with all of our might, and it feels like we take one step forward and two steps back. Our church was, our sheep were being tossed around by things in the media and things that we didn't do right and things we wish we would have done, but it was just, you want to talk about fighting against the winds and the waves. 2019 was a lot like that for us, for me. But look at the verse. And when evening came, the boat was out in the sea, and he was alone on the land, and he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. Brothers and sisters, Jesus sees. He's watching. He sees it all. He watched us in that boardroom calling out to him and struggling. He sees it all, and he sees you. He sees you fighting against the wind and the waves, but he doesn't just see you. He doesn't just see you. He's also coming to you. Verse 48, halfway through, and about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea, and he meant to pass by them. Jesus is coming to them. He's been up on the mountain. He's been praying and watching. He's doing both. He's praying. I don't know what he was praying about. Maybe he was praying about what just happened during the day and thanking his Father for the miracle, or maybe he was praying about the disciples and their lack of faith, or maybe he was praying that the people wouldn't make him king, right? I don't know what he was praying about, but he was praying, but he was also watching. I'm guessing that in this long night, he prayed for his disciples, intercessory prayer, I'm guessing. But I know it says right here that he saw them and he's watching. No matter what you do, no matter what you're facing, Jesus is coming to you. Make no mistake. When the winds and the waves are against you, Jesus has a plan, and his plan is to come to you. Look at what it says again right there in the scripture. In about the fourth watch of the night. The fourth watch of the night is like 3 to 6 a.m. All right. So I don't know how long the disciples have been out fighting against the winds and waves, but they were told to get in the boat when it was still kind of dusk. So maybe they stopped at Bethsaida. There's like some debate exactly how the disciples, their route and what they went, but they were out there for a long time. And Jesus comes at 3 a.m. to them walking on the water. I find it very interesting that Jesus didn't come on the first watch of the night. Because if I'm in the boat, if he comes on the first watch of the night, I would have said, well, thanks, Jesus. I'm glad that you came. But, you know, we probably would have figured this out on our own eventually. But thanks for coming anyway. But at the fourth watch of the night, when you've been out there for hours and hours and hours, and you've been fighting and fighting and fighting, and your sail of self-sufficiency is tattered and shattered and ripped apart on the bottom of your boat, and you're at the end of yourself, Jesus says, all right, we got something now. And here he comes. Never too late, never too, say it, early. He's right on time. He always is. While you are wrestling, worrying, and wondering what God is doing, he is watching, working, and waiting to come to you at the perfect time and in the perfect way to fulfill his perfect plan. That's a long sentence, but oh my, that's a sentence. While you are wrestling, worrying, and wondering what God is doing, he is watching, working, and waiting to come to you at the perfect time and in the perfect way to fulfill his perfect plan. He is sovereign over your storm. He is sovereign over your storm. And before we go to the next point, I want to just stop here and I want to do a little theology teaching and then a little application. All right? So let's talk about it. Sovereignty, and then we'll talk about our response. So let's talk about God's sovereignty for a second, all right? The first thing about God's sovereignty is that there's always a purpose. God has a purpose for everything. God does not react, okay? He doesn't react. God has a purpose, and his purpose are so beyond what we can even imagine. The Bible says his ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. But he has a purpose, and you can always be sure that there is a purpose. And you can try to figure it out, but our minds are so tiny and puny compared to God's. But he has a purpose. Secondly, he has a plan. God knows in his sovereignty the beginning from the end. Every intricate little detail of your storm, he knows the beginning from the end and everything in between. And it's all planned out. That's what sovereignty means. Sovereignty means to be supreme in authority or supreme in control. And so he has a purpose. He has a plan. Thirdly, he has power. He doesn't just have a purpose and a plan. He has the power to deliver it. I love Jeremiah 32. It says that, what does it say? I might have to pull it up. I quoted it this week. Jeremiah 32 says, "Is anything too hard for me?" What an interesting question that God says of himself. And of course, the answer is no, because he has all the power. Next, he presides, and this is important too. In his sovereignty, he didn't just make a plan of old, although he knew it from the beginning. And he didn't just make the plan and then go off somewhere else and decide he's going to do something else while his plan just happens over there. He presides over it. He's involved intricately in every detail, and he's there for you, and he knows what's happening. He knows how you're feeling in the midst of it because he's sovereign. And then the last thing is he's perfect in his plan. The plan is working out for his glory and your good. That's sovereignty. And he is sovereign in your storm, wherever you are today. All of those things are true about what you're facing. If those things are true, let's get to the application. This is our response. How should we respond to the truth of God's sovereignty over everything, but particularly as it relates to your storm? By the way, John 16:33, make sure that everybody understands. You see it there at the bottom of the storm thing in the middle of the chart. In this world, you will have tribulation. But take heart, I've overcome the world. That's the storm. But now let's go to the response. Here's our response. First is prayer. First is prayer. Our first response in the middle of a storm is to go to him. We've just talked about it. We prayed this morning. Jesus gives us a great example. You need to pray. What else is our application or our response? Number two, patience. Patience. Wait on the Lord. Be encouraged and take heart. Wait on the Lord. Psalm 27:4. Wait on him. Why? Because he, say the S word. Say the S word, sovereign. That's not a swear word. The S word is sovereign this morning. You're going to be patient because you know God is sovereign. All right? You can be patient because you're trusting in God because you know that he's got it. And all those things on the left side are true. Thirdly, my response is perseverance. Perseverance. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised for those who love him. Perseverance is our response. We don't freak out. We keep rowing. We keep rowing because we know it's going to end up ultimately for God's glory and our good. I might not be able to see it, and it might be hard. I might be sweating. I might be soaked. But I'm going to persevere because I know the truth of God's sovereignty. Next, peace. Peace is our response. I can have peace in the middle of the storm. That's my word for 2020 is peace. And I can have it no matter what God brings. You keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Why do I put those verses up there, by the way? I put those verses up there for you to know that what I'm teaching you now isn't my thoughts. These are from God's word. And I also put the verses up so you can have some fun this week and study it. Either you should write it down or take a picture so you can study the verses. Last thing, my response is to praise. Praise. I see the writer of Yes, I Will out here in Eddie Hogan. Yes, I Will says, I will pray. What does it say? Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I praise. That's your response. So that's our first point. Hopefully that will encourage you, challenge you. But let's remind each other of this as we go through life together as brothers and sisters in the Lord. God is sovereign, and how should I respond? Second point. It is I am clarity in your confusion. Verse 49. Well, wait a minute. Let me just give a little comment on he meant to pass by them because it's kind of a little confusing. He meant to pass by them doesn't mean that he wanted to go around them or he wanted to just fly by them. He wanted to pass by them so they all could see him. The actual word that's used there in the Greek is connected to the word in Hebrew for when Moses was told by God to put himself in the cleft of the rock and he would pass by so Moses could see his glory. Jesus is passing by so they could see that he's walking on the water. He's not trying to get around them. Okay, because that is a little confusing. All right, next point. It is I am clarity in your confusion. Verse 49. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. They're confused. The disciples are confused and they're frightened. They see this figure coming closer and closer. And though it looks like Jesus, they think that it can't be Jesus. It must be a ghost that's trying to deceive them. They're confused. And why are they confused? Well, I don't know if this is exactly right, but this is what I think. I think they were confused because they put Jesus in a box. They had put Jesus in a box that limited who he really is. We see it a little bit later that their faith, they're still growing in their faith, but they're limiting who Jesus really is. And before we poo-poo the disciples, I do this. Maybe you do this too. We take attributes of Jesus that we're comfortable with or that make us feel best. And then we put Jesus in that box. We put a little ribbon on it. We put our name on the box. And we say, that's Jesus. That's my Jesus. But then when he shows up in different ways than I have him in my little box, I get confused. And sometimes that could even frighten me. Do you look at Jesus in just the ways that make you feel comfortable? I think that's kind of maybe what the disciples did. Maybe not comfort, but their limited understanding of Jesus. They had put him in this thing, and then Jesus comes, and they are like, what? How? His example, is Jesus to be your friend, or is he to be feared? What's the answer? The answer is yes to both. He is to be your friend, but he's also to be feared. In my little Jesus box, I tend to move towards the Jesus to be feared category. And that makes me react to Jesus and react to you in certain ways because I lean to this. Instead of the right picture of Jesus, he is to be my friend. And I need to enlarge my understanding of the true Jesus, but instead, I kind of go over here and then I'll judge you when you want to hang out over there. You can see I'm preaching to myself about things I'm learning as I prepare God's word. But let the awesomeness of the real Jesus destroy our little boxes so we can see with clarity the totality of who Jesus really is. And the cool thing is you never, ever get to the end of the understanding of how great Jesus is. How much more he is than we can even think. But they're scared. Look at verse 50. For they all saw him and they were terrified. They were terrified. But God is not a God of confusion, but of powerful, profound, purposeful clarity. When I'm fighting the waves and the wind, I need to be looking for Jesus. Why? Well, look at the verse. For they all saw him and were terrified, but immediately he spoke to them and said, take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. When I'm fighting the waves and the wind, I need to look to Jesus. Why? Because he will speak to me a word. He will speak to me a word that will be exactly what I need to hear. In my storm, I need to look for Jesus because he's going to speak to me a word exactly what I need to hear. He says, take heart, it is I. You can see he didn't say, take heart, guys, it's me, Jesus. The disciples could see that it was Jesus. They just didn't believe it. He doesn't say, it's me, Jesus. He says, it is I. It is who you think it is. Jesus didn't show up. This is important. Jesus didn't show up and say, hey guys, you're going to be okay now because I brought you a bigger boat. He didn't show up and say, hey guys, you're going to be all right because I got some holy life preservers for you and it'll make sure that everything will be okay. I even put like that fish symbol that you guys are going to use about me. It's on the life preserver. It's really cool. He didn't do that. He came and he says one thing to disciples. He says, it is I. Take heart. Don't be afraid. This is really important. Very important. The deliverance in the midst of your storm is not the exchange of some temporal provision from Jesus. It's the presence of Jesus himself that will bring clarity to your confused heart. It is on the board. Great job, Rob. This is an important statement. The deliverance in the midst of your storm is not the exchange of something he can give you, though he will. He's so giving, he's so kind, and he knows exactly what you need. But the real provision is not the stuff. It's the Savior himself. He will bring clarity to your confusion by his presence. That's what this message is about, the power of his presence. It's Jesus. 10 years ago this month, I was diagnosed with MS. And it's amazing. I was 44 years old. And I remember going to Mayo Clinic. And I'd gotten a preliminary diagnosis that they thought it could be. But I just kind of had my doubts. I'm like, I can't have MS. I've never been sick hardly a day of my life. I'm an athlete. I can control my body. I've always had the best of everything with my health. I've never had an issue. It can't be. The doctor came in the room to me and Chris and said, you have MS. It was like a wind shear. And it was confusing. What are you doing, God? What is happening? Why? All these things that all of us ask when we're in the middle of a storm. I, at 44, could play basketball with my kids that were like, I don't even know what their ages were. I could play with 20-year-olds and I could just beat the pants off of them at 44 years old. And all of a sudden, it was gone. The sports pastor was no longer the sports pastor, that guy who was good at sports. I couldn't hardly walk. No, that's not true. I couldn't walk without a limp, as you guys know. Still walking with a limp. By the way, if I didn't have MS, I'd still kick all those kids' butts in basketball. I want you to know that, Brian. So, but was confusing. But the presence of God, I'm just telling you. Jesus came to me, walking on the water, and the presence of God calmed all of my confusion, gave me clarity. God wanted to do some things. He wanted to humble me. He wanted to teach me perseverance. He wanted me to have more empathy with all the things that you guys are going through. He wanted me to be prayed for more by all of you. There are so many things that when God showed up and I actually went to God, I saw all these blessings. But it was Jesus himself, wasn't the things. And I want that for all of you, no matter where you are today. He's coming. He's coming. Whether he's with you now, he always is with you, but whether he's answering you the way you want to be answered or whether he hasn't yet, that's the key word, yet. If the God of the wind and the waves was with me, let the wind howl and let the sea billows roar, because it is well with my soul. The very God that created the winds and the waves is never going to leave me nor forsake me. He's watching, he's working, and he's waiting to answer. So how do I recognize him? You guys know I love application. So here it is. Presence, power for clarity. Presence, power for clarity. If you're in the midst of a storm, how do you recognize him? And there's three ways. Number one is you look. You look to him. And you look to him through his word and look for him in your circumstances. Obviously, the word of God brings so much clarity. If there's I learned a bunch of things in 2019. I learned a lot about prayer and dependence on God, but I also learned about the clarity of God's word. Go to God's word when you're confused. You need to look to Jesus, the word of God, in his word. And he will speak to you. Secondly, look for God in your circumstances. What are you trying to teach me, God? Because I know, I believe that sovereignty thing. I believe that your plan is perfect. So obviously there's something in here for me. So look to him. Secondly, listen for him. And what are the ways that we listen for him in the midst of our storms? Number one, we get counsel. You are sitting alongside many, many godly, loving people that God wants to use to speak something into your life. Are you going to them? Or are you huddled up in your boat all alone? Or are you asking people to join with you? Come on my boat for a while. Some people maybe won't want to do it, but hopefully your brothers who love you will come with you on your boat. Secondly, you listen to God in prayer. It's a two-way thing. James 1:5 says you're supposed to ask God in wisdom when you're in the midst of a trial. And he's going to give you generously, without reproach. You need to go to him, and then you need to listen. God's Spirit will speak to you. And then you got some good counsel just to make sure that it's wise. Thirdly, you get to him, to listen to him through testimony. Next week, hopefully we'll have some baptisms. You'll listen to God. How is God speaking through other people's testimony? God wants to speak to you when other people are praising him. Listen. And then lastly, listen in song. The song Mention of Your Name got me through 2019, one of the things. Mention of your name. Mention of your name. I wore it out. But God spoke to me through that song. Now he's speaking to me through Canvas in the Clay is the current song. He speaks to you, and you look for him in those places and listen. And then lastly, you let him in. You let him in your boat. You're going to see in a second that Jesus is going to go into the boat with the disciples. You have to let Jesus in. And how do you do that? You confess. God, I can't do this alone. My power is made perfect in weakness, God, and I am weak. Oh, God, I invite you in. And the other way that you let him in is you surrender. God, I am not in control. And I'm not going to try to control it. I'm not going to get upset about not being able to control it. I am giving control to you, God. Come into my boat and steer. Come into my boat and row. Come into my boat and calm the storm. God, Jesus, join me in my boat. It is I am clarity in your confusion. Look at verse 51. And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. Say miracle. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. Jesus is sovereign, and he's going to bring clarity to your confusion. But it's interesting here, the disciples were still learning. It wasn't perfectly clear yet. Their Jesus school was still in session. They had more to learn. No matter how long you've walked alongside Jesus, there is more for you to learn, and your faith can be grown. Your faith can be grown. These guys didn't see it clearly yet. They're still, their hearts were confused. They didn't get it yet, but God is teaching them and lovingly showing them. And God's going to do that for you too. It's really interesting. They were all astonished. You see it? Utterly astonished or astounded. I don't know if that's a statement of lack of faith or not. I don't know whether to be amazed by God's things all the time or be like totally expected. So I'm wondering, I'm amazed by stuff God's doing all the time. And I wonder, is that a lack of faith because I'm so surprised or astounded that he's doing it? But then I want to be astounded because I think it's a cool thing to be astounded at Jesus is so awesome. So I'm kind of stuck. I don't know which is right or wrong. I want to be astounded, but I want to expect it. So I don't know. They're both probably great. I don't know. But you can see, Jesus is lovingly teaching them by this demonstration debrief. So that's the second point. It is I am clarity in your confusion. Here's the last point. It is I am hope for your healing. It is I am hope for your healing. Verse 53. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment, and many as touched it were made well. While verse 45 to 52 show how Jesus comes to us, verses 53 through 56 show us how we should go to him. I love the reaction of these people. They realized that Jesus was their only hope. Their hope wasn't in a man. Their hope wasn't in a method. Their hope wasn't in money. Their hope wasn't in a mystic or some medicine. It was in the miracle worker, the Messiah, the Master Jesus, and they understood it and they took action. I see their action in five ways, and then we'll close. Number one, they come to him with urgency. See it there? Verse 55 or 54, start there. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region. I love that. They're coming to him with urgency. Jesus is here. We got to get the people to him. The sick people, the hurting people, the demonized people. The confused people. Secondly, they come to him on behalf of others. They ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their behalf. This is about the people that are bringing their friends. There's this intercessory thing. They're bringing their friends. Are you bringing your friends to Jesus? I love that about these people. They're bringing people to Jesus. They're doing it on behalf of others. They come in faith. It's kind of through the whole passage. You realize that these people understood that Jesus could heal them. They're fired up with faith. I like that. Fourthly, they come to him no matter the cost. You can see it. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, these people are traveling. They're bringing their sick people. This is not easy. There's a cost to coming to Jesus, and they're willing to pay it no matter where he is. We're going to go get the people and get them to Jesus. That's awesome. This is how we should come to Jesus. Lastly, they come to him with desperate fervency. Verse 56, wherever he came in the villages, cities, or countries, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the garments. I love that. Just a touch of his clothes, and they're imploring him. They're begging him. They're praying to him in fervency. My hand is still numb, and my fingers don't work. My left arm isn't very strong. You guys see me still walk with a limp. None of it is better. None of it's healed. But I am so much better in the heart. My heart is healed. Jesus will heal you too. He may not heal you exactly how you prayed, but he will heal you perfectly because you prayed. I don't know what perfect is for you, but God knows what's perfect healing for you. And trust me, you might want to be able to walk and limp and play basketball again, but God knows what's best for you. And he's going to heal you perfectly if you go to him in prayer, if you go to him like these people did. He still heals today. He's the same God of Gennesaret. And so go to him. Go to him. He is the hope for your healing. He is clarity in your confusion. And he is sovereign over your storm. All right. We're going to give you a chance to go to him now. About a month ago, Pastor Eddie asked people to come forward to humble themselves and to ask forgiveness and repent. And the front was filled across all of our campuses. But we're going to give you a chance today to come forward in supplication. Come forward with your needs. I know I'm your pastor, and I know some of you are going through so many hard storms. If you want Jesus' presence increasingly more and more in your storm, we're going to open up the front during this song. I want you to come. I want you to let the action of getting out of your seat and coming here be a sign to Jesus, be a message to Jesus that, oh God, your presence is what I seek. Some of you are confused and unsure and like, God, what are you doing? And God, I need wisdom. God, I need insight. I need clarity. And if you're there today, when we start singing, come up and come and pray. And then lastly, some of you just need healing. And I don't know. You can come now. That a girl, Colleen. You're not even waiting. I like it. Come on. Yeah, no, that's good, Colleen. But if you need healing today, and you want to call out to God, and you need a touch, I just need a hem, just a hem of your garment, God. I want you to come now as we sing. I'll pray over us about halfway through the song, and then we're going to worship our faces off because God is awesome, is he not? He's awesome.